humanity.
الرحيم هبني عطاك يا أنت الكريم منك العطاء يا أنت العظيم.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين وعلى من تبع هداهم إلى يوم الدين. Indeed, all praises due to Allah, and may peace and blessings be upon His Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wa sallam. Dear viewers from the brothers and the sisters, as you remember, we have started, alhamdulillah, a new set of episodes entitled The Prophet Counseling. And that is a story from Adam alayhi salam, the creation of Adam. So today, inshallah, we'll continue from that moment, from that point, when Adam alayhi salam, he said, wa alaykum as-salam wa rahmatullah. Prophet ﷺ had emphasized the importance of the salutation. We see, for example, from the Prophet ﷺ's hadith, he said, وَالَّذِي نَفْسِي بِيَدِهِ, that is, لَا تَدْخُلُونَ الْجَنَّةِ, you will not enter paradise, حَتَّى تُؤْمِنُوا, until you believe. وَلَا تُؤْمِنُوا حَتَّى تَحَابُوا, and you will not gain the proper and the complete belief until you love one another. أَلَا أَدُلُّكُمْ عَلَى شَيْءٍ إِذَا فَعَلْتُمُوهُ تَحَابَبْتُمْ. Shall I inform you of something, an act that you do, that if you do it, you will love one another? أَفْشُوا السَّلَامَ بَيْنَكُمْ, that is, spread the salam amongst you. سَلَامُ عَلَيْكُمْ, this is the greeting of Adam alayhi salam, down to all the prophets, including our last prophet, the greatest of all prophets, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Peace be upon you. And we see that other people, when they greet one another, unfortunately even from the Muslims, they greet them with greetings which are not Islamic. They say, for example, hello and other issues. Assalamu alaikum is better. Peace be upon you. What better than peace? And remember, the peace, assalam, is one of the names of Allah Azza wa Jal. When you have the name of Allah, the peace, that you are starting your and initiating your talk and conversation by saying, assalamu alaikum, mashallah. Peace be upon you. So you started with the peace. And our religion is based upon peace. Our religion is the ambassador of peace. It is peace. Assalamu alaikum. Prophet ﷺ, he came peace to the whole world. The whole of Islam is to submit your will to the will of the creator of heaven and earth. And also, assalam, al-Islam. Two names common, al-Islam, was-salam. It is a peace. It's a wrong issue to portray a different idea about Islam. That is, that Islam is a terrorism. Wallahi, it is not. Islam, as I said, is the ambassador of peace. Peace be upon you. Assalamu alaikum. As we said, regardless of how many times you said assalamu alaikum to the person, but the issue is that when you depart from your brother, you, for example, pass by a tree, then you could return the salam again. There's a story of this man in the Prophet ﷺ's time and in the Prophet ﷺ's masjid. He was praying fast. He was not calm in his prayer. So he finished his prayer. He went to the Prophet ﷺ and he said, Assalamu alayka ya Rasulullah. Peace be upon you, Messenger of Allah. He said, Wa alayka salam. And also peace be upon you. Go back and pray again, for you haven't prayed. So the man went again. So he did not leave the Messenger of Allah a long distance. He says, still in the masjid. He prayed again. And after he finished the prayer, which was the same prayer as the first one, that means it was a fast prayer. He came back to the Prophet ﷺ. He said, Assalamu alayka ya Rasulullah. Peace be upon you, Messenger of Allah. Prophet of Allah replied, Wa alayka salam. And peace also be upon you. But go back, for you haven't prayed. So the man prayed for the third time, the same way that he had prayed in the first and the second time, with no tranquility. Came back to the Prophet ﷺ. Peace be upon you. Prophet ﷺ said, And peace be upon you. But go back, for you haven't prayed. Now the Prophet ﷺ, at the end of the story, told him, that you need to perfect your prayer, you need to pray with tranquility. But the important issue is that the Prophet ﷺ never said to him, come on, stop saying salam again, because you just said salam a moment ago. He did not say that. So he returned the salam. So he went and he went back. So that is why the Prophet ﷺ, he was amongst the companions. Every time there's a tree would separate two companions from one another, they would return and say salamu alaikum. But I would like here to shed light upon some important points here. Number one, there's some people, for example, in one gathering where they haven't really moved, and a person wants, for example, to set a question to the sheikh or the da'iyah. So he starts his question with, assalamu alaikum ya sheikh, salamu alaikum, oh brother. So this is not from the sunnah. The sunnah, we said that if something would separate between you and your brother, no problem to return and say salamu alaikum. But if you're still in the same gathering, in the same setting, that means you are with your brother sitting on the same table. You can't every second say salamu alaikum, brother. And a brother say alaikum assalam, salamu alaikum, brother. I think it would be provoking here. But we say that if the person, for example, moved from one room to another, then he would say salamu alaikum. That's the first issue. Second issue is the people when they, for example, give a call. For example, he wants to give a call, or is WhatsApping his brother, or is Vibering his brother, lots of technology these days. So this person is picking up the phone and he's ringing his brother. So as soon as the other person would pick up the phone, this person who had initiated the call, he would say to him, assalamu alaikum. Or the person who is at the other end would say, initiate, assalamu alaikum. Now, which one is the correct one? Is it the person who had initiated the call or the person who had received the call? Now, we see that the habit of the people, most of the habit, is that the person who receives the call, as soon as he picks up the call, he would say, assalamu alaikum. Especially if he knows the number, if he comes up with a name. Now, this is not from the sunnah. Now, imagine that you are coming to a house and you knock in the door of a house. And the person who is inside the house, he would say to you, assalamu alaikum. Is that the right way? It's supposed to be that when the person opens the door, the person who knocked the door, he should say assalamu alaikum. Not the person who's inside the house, before even he opens the door, or when he opened the door, he would say assalamu alaikum. It's the other way around. So we tell the person when you ring somebody else, that is, the caller, you should say assalamu alaikum. But what about if that person who's a non-Muslim, he said assalamu alaikum, clear. Okay, they say assalamu alaikum, you know, this is the way to talk to an Arab or talk to a Muslim. They say assalamu alaikum, for example, assalamu alaikum. Now, should I say to him wa alaikum? Now, this is injustice. I cannot treat this person who said assalamu alaikum, another person who says assalamu alaikum, which is death upon you. I can't treat them the same. And I say to them wa alaikum, and upon you. But I would rather say wa alaikum assalam, and peace be upon you. So I cannot initiate the salam, but I could reply the salam. I could say, wa alaykum as-salam. And this is how the companions dealt with the non-Muslims, how the companions dealt with the Jews and the Christians and other people. So we say that the person, if he was clear with as-salamu alaykum, the reply would say, wa alaykum as-salam. So regardless, Muslim or non-Muslim, but the Muslim, you could add, and it's better to add, wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Remember, the mercy of Allah is only upon the person who had fulfilled his obligation towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Almighty, and he fulfilled his obligation towards his Prophet, regardless his Prophet was Isa alayhi salam at the time of Isa, or his Prophet was Musa alayhi salam at the time of Musa, or his Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which is our Prophet. We fulfill our duty towards him, and we set ourselves upon the path that he drew for us. Wallahu ta'ala a'lam. So this is now the peace of Allah be upon you, the greeting of all the prophets from Adam alayhi salam to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Now, in the story of Adam, back to the story now, Adam alayhi salam, Allah azza wa jal had put his hands in front of Adam alayhi salam, and his hands were closed. Now, what is our position regarding the hand of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? What does that mean? First of all, we have to look onto this with the other text. First of all, we know that Allah Azza wa Jal, he says, لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ وَهُوَ السَّمِيعُ الْبَصِيرُ. There is nothing like unto him. And he is the all-hearing, the all-seeing. And I'm pointing, because Abu Huraira, when he narrated this ayah, and he narrated this hadith, he was pointing with his thumb to his ear, and his index to his eyes, like this. The all-hearing, the all-seeing. So this is the way that the companions explain it, so we should know now how the companions had understood the attributes, inshallah. After the break, we will tell you how the attributes is to be interpreted. Wallahu ta'ala a'lam.
أرجو رضاك يا أنت الرحيم هبني عطاك يا
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. After we had the break and we go back to the explanation of a very important issue, that is the hand of Allah and all the attributes of Allah, where Allah Azza wa Jal had described himself in his book and also his Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he described him in his Sunnah. Now those descriptions, how do we deal with it? We said there is a very great principle, that is the ayah, laysa kamithli shay'. There is nothing like unto him. This is now to, we could say, reject and encounter all of those arguments that come to us regarding the issue of, yeah, you are giving a similarity to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Almighty. No, there's nothing like unto him. But at the same time, we need to have affirmation for his attributes. He is the all-hearing and the all-seeing. Now we understand what is the hearing, but we don't understand how Allah hears. Now as for us, we know that the person, when he talks, he transmits some sound, and that sound, you know, transmits into waves, and the waves, it has to be within certain decibels. If it's higher than the 20,000, can't hear it. If it's lower than the 20 decibels, can't hear it. But this is not to do with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He hears according to his majesty. Laysa kamithli shay. There's nothing like unto him. So we affirm the hearing, but we say that Allah ta'ala a'lam, Allah knows best how he hears. Allah sees. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he sees. But the way he sees is different from ours. We absolve Allah to be similar to any of his creatures. لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ وَهُوَ السَّمِيعُ الْبَصِيرُ. Always remember that verse. There's nothing like unto him, and he is all hearing, the all seeing. See, like we are establishing the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has got a that, the essence of Allah. Allah, he has the essence. So like we affirm the essence of Allah, we also affirm the attributes of Allah. We cannot say Allah has got no essence, because if we said he's got an essence, that means we are giving him a similarity to his creatures. No, he has an essence, and because he's got an essence, he's got attributes. This essence, it can't be no characteristics for it. But this characteristics or those attributes, we only give it as Allah had given to himself. We cannot give in any single attribute to Allah except what he had given to himself or his Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam described him with. So Allah Azza wa Jal, he has al-asma al-husna wa sifat al-ula. That is the most beautiful names. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he has the most beautiful names and the most beautiful attributes, the Almighty Azza wa Jal. So we cannot describe him except that he is Allah. الفرد الصمد الأحد الواحد الذي لا إله إلا هو الحي القيوم. Allah Azza wa Jal, he describes himself with number of names, more than 99. As some people, they think it's only 99. There's more than 99 names. And of course he has so many attributes, and each name entails an attribute of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he puts his hands to Adam alayhi salam, and that means he's got two hands. Allah has got two hands. يدي لما خلقت بيدي. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he asked Iblis, why didn't you prostrate to something which I have created with my own two hands? So Allah has got to two hands, which is suitable to his majesty. So he said to him, choose, and Allah's hand was closed, so he doesn't know what is in it. So he chose the right hand. What does it mean, the right hand? It means Allah's got right and got left. It means, see, the person as a human being, right and left, and his right is used for honorable things. And his left is used for example, you know, the cleaning things and the stinger and all of that. This is nothing to do with Allah. Both Allah's hands are to be blessed, suitable to his majesty. We absolve Allah to look like any of his creatures. لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ. There's nothing like unto him. So he said to him, choose. So Adam alayhi salam, he said, اخْتَرْتُ يَمِينَ رَبِّي. I have chosen the right hand of my Lord. And both hands, he said, are to be blessed. So when Allah opens his hand, right hand, for Adam alayhi salam, he looks and he sees things there. And Adam alayhi salam is inquiring, who are these? He says to him, the Almighty, those are your offspring. These are your descendants. This is from the moment when Adam alayhi salam approached his spouse Hawa, and they have produced the offsprings until the day of judgment. All of them. And between the eyes of each person, there is like the age of that person. Now Adam scanned through them and he found, there's a narration says, min adwa'ihim aw or adwa'uhum, the most glowing person or one of the most glowing. Now I will know, even though the most glowing, it has to be the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, nobody else. Because the Prophet of Allah, he is the best of all creation. Even that we have, saying from the scholar, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is better than Angel Jibreel alayhi salam. Because he went to the lote tree and he could not go beyond it. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he went beyond it, but Jibreel alayhi salam could not go beyond it. So we have now the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he's the most glowing, but he had seen one of the most glowing. And what maybe captured his attention, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he had given him a very short lifespan. So he said to him, who is this, my Lord? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala replied, this is your son Dawood. So he doesn't know his name, Dawood. Oh Allah, how many years you have given him? He's asking to confirm. So Allah the Almighty said to him, I have given him 40. Then Adam alayhi salam, he's got many years, 1,000 years. Like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam before he died, that your death is approaching. So Adam alayhi salam had plenty of years. He said, oh Allah, give him from my age some of these years now, 40. If he was 60, give him 40, make it 100. If he was 40, give him 60 to make it 100. Whether he gave him 40 or 60 to make the age of Dawood alayhi salam to be 100. And you know for a fact that, you know, that it is true that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is capable of giving plenty of years without taking, you know, from the years of Adam and giving it to Dawood alayhi salam. He doesn't need to do that. But Adam alayhi salam, this is the story to learn something from this. Adam alayhi salam, his generosity now, he's given from a 1,000 years. When you give 40 or 60, you know, it's not that really that much. You're not giving that much. And just to show that we are the sons of Adam. We offer when we are, you know, we got plenty of money, plenty of food, we'll offer. But we're not the same. We're not having got that much. So Adam alayhi salam, when he given that, so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, okay, let it be. If you want it like this, let it be. Now then Adam alayhi salam, he had forgotten the command of Allah azza wa jal that is regarding eating from the tree. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he sends him down to the earth. And then Adam was counting for himself. So he's counting, even though it's a long lifespan, but he forgot that he already had given 40, according to the narration, to Dawood, the son of his. So when he was counting to himself, now he's approaching 960, he got 40 years to go. Now the angel of death was sent down to Adam alayhi salam. The angel of death, he came to Adam. Adam alayhi salam recognized the angel of death. He said to him, it is not your time. You came, you know, a bit fast. Still another 40 years to go. So the angel of death reminded him of something that took place a long time, 960 years ago. We forget sometimes what sort of dinner we had last night, never mind to remember something, because 960 years ago, you can't do that. It's almost impossible to remember something that really you have done about 50 years ago. I would say some people got good memory, but not for 960. So he said to him, do you remember? You have given 60 years to your son Dawood alayhi salam. So he said, I can't remember. He forgot. And that's why we forget. And because he forgot, he denied. He said, I did not give him. It's not because he had given him and he lied. No, never think that about the prophets. They don't lie, the prophets. He forgot. And that's why we forget, because we are the sons of Adam. And that's how he forgot as well the command of Allah not to eat from the tree. It's not because he remembered and he wanted to disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala deliberately. No, he forgot the command of Allah. And he forgot now he had given 40 years or 60 years to his son Dawood. So he's given him that age, so he said he forgot. And that is why we forget. And he denied, and that's why we deny. We are the sons of Adam. Since that day, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Prophet said, that is the shuhud and the kitabah. That means the writing was obligated and taking witnesses was obligatory. So that was the time of the Prophet Adam alayhi salam. It is compulsory for the person, if he makes something like a deal or he makes an offer or he makes a transaction, he has to write it down and also he has to take witnesses. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he knows that this ummah is the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He had given it lots of concessions. Allah azza wa jal had given us lots of concessions. Not only that, he likes us to be embarked upon the concessions more than to embark upon the hard. Like for example, when you are traveling The prayer becomes from 4 rak'ah in the dhuhr, 4 rak'ah in the asr, to 2 rak'ah. And Allah wants you to pray the 2 rak'ah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants you to do the concession that He has given you. So this concession He has given to this ummah. Imagine the prayer was to be 50 prayers a day. How hard is it going to be upon us? But Allah Azza wa made it for us. 5 prayers, not only that. With each prayer has a multiple of 10. Multiple of 10 prayers. That means we have the rewards of making 50 prayers, even though we are making 5 prayers. With this concession, alhamdulillah, that Allah Azza wa Jal, He had given us a concession in Surah Al-Baqarah, in the verse of Surah Al-Baqarah. That Allah Azza wa Jal, He said, if you are a person who is trusting that person, you are trusting the one that you are giving him, for example, let's say a loan. No problem if you trust him, that is, to not to take witnesses, not to write down. But if this person has been trusted, he should fulfill his trust. This person, because that brother of his, mashallah, you trusted him, he should fulfill his trust. But let's say you have given a brother whom you have trusted some money. You did not take a witness, no, you have written it down. Now that person somehow, his character changed. A person from being righteous became unrighteous. What should you do now in this case? Now the Prophet ﷺ, he said, if you have done that, then suit yourself. It is your mistake. Allah told you, it is better, it's not a command now anymore, it is better to take witnesses. It is better to write it down. You have trusted him, alhamdulillah. But that person, as I said, the person might change. If he had changed now, and he did not give you the money, now you have lost the money maybe here, in this dunya. But in the hereafter, Allah Azza wa Jal will give you. Of course, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had warned us regarding the debt, that we should fulfill the debt. Even the martyr, which is the person who does the best of the acts, on the day of resurrection, everything will be forgiven for him, except for huquq al-ibad. That is the rights of the people, and that is the debt. Prophet of Allah had emphasized that. When a companion came to ask the Prophet of Allah about the martyr, he said, is it everything forgiven for him? He said to him, yes, from the first gush of blood. And when he went, he said to him, come back, except for the debt. Jibreel had told me about it. The debt will not be forgiven. So I would rather tell the brothers who take the money of other people, make sure that you return it back. Because on the day of resurrection, it's not going to be about money. There is no bank accounts there. You could really borrow money and give your brother. It's going to be your hasanat. That is your rewards which you have earned with your sweat. Now those hasanat can be abolished, can be taken away. So they're going to be taken from their own sins and dropping their sins upon you. This is the end of this episode, inshallah, that we have gained a lot of benefit from it. أسأل الله سبحانه وتعالى أن يجعلنا ممن يستمع القول فيتبع أحسنه وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين جزاكم الله خيرا.
الله الله يا ربي يا الله الله يا ربي يا الله
لا إله إلا الله لا إله إلا الله لا إله إلا الله محمد رسول